So I've noticed that a lot of gacha players, I guess more of the traditional gacha players, don't actually play Genshin Impact. And just by looking at the market and the revenue, Genshin Impact is still probably the dominating gacha game, although at this point, can you really call it a gacha game exclusively? And so today in this video, I wanted to go ahead and do my breakdown of Genshin Impact, open up a discussion, and let's talk about why you wouldn't be playing Genshin Impact. Because to be honest, it is pretty intriguing. It is actually a pretty freaking crazy game. Hi, welcome back to my channel. My name is Lace, and today we've got a different kind of video. Like I said before, I want to be exploring as to why you, or like the majority of gacha gamers, traditional gacha gamers, wouldn't be wanting to play a game like this. And so therefore in this video, I'll quickly go through like the different features of what you may be missing out on, but then I wanted to go through a list of different reasons that I've compiled together as to why I think gacha gamers are not fond of this game. Yes, there are millions and millions of people that are playing worldwide, however, I feel like it's actually not captured a large amount of the gacha players, which is kind of mind-boggling, right? But like, I mean more, it's found a lot of the PC players, a lot of the console players. So let's start off with some of the features, right? And I think the biggest feature that Genshin Impact is known for is this open world exploration. For me, I think this is a fantastic feature. It's exactly what the game is based around. And to be honest, and I understand that all of this could be down to taste, but in my opinion, open world just gives a lot more of an immersive experience, right? Because like, you don't have to go through loading screens. It just feels like you're walking on and on and on, potentially until you hit endgame. And so after that, what we have here are a whole bunch of moderately well-written characters, because there are some that are kind of cringy, to be honest. Like in a lot of the story, Zhongli is very, very wise. He also is struggling with a whole bunch of different things, being like a 1,000-year-old dude, or like many thousands year old. Back in Mondstadt, you also had Jean and Deluc and Mona, and they were like, I just felt like they were quite a strong cast. On top of that, the production value is pretty insane, right? Like the music, but in particular, I wanted to talk about the VAs. They have pretty much all of the big names in here. We've got like Amelia over here. We've got Megumin. Pretty sure Kirito is somewhere in Razor. And then on top of that, you've also got the profile, in which you've got a whole bunch of stories as well as voiceovers, stuff like that. However, I will touch on the moderately well-written characters later. Then after that, we've got a rotating end game mode, which is this spiral abyss over here. And I think a lot of people, most people do think that this is a pretty good game mode for end game, especially because it has like rotating floors. And so it's just these guys over here. We've got 9, 10, 11, 12. So you got to bring in like a couple of teams, and then every week or every 2 weeks, sorry, these guys are going to rotate in and out, typically floor 11 or 12. Although some could argue that this is insufficient for end game. And so we can discuss that later again. Otherwise, in terms of the gacha itself, I think the pity system is actually quite good. It's 90 rolls for the hard pity, but like generally, I don't think like anyone has actually gone over 86. You'd have to be pretty freaking unlucky to get that. Most people will hit about like 75 to 85. And on top of that, like not hitting the banner character the first time will net you the guarantee on the next one. So that means that you can always be able to hit the character that you want within about 150 to 180 pulls. I think the income itself is quite decent. Like look at the amount of gems that I've been able to save. I'm not strictly free to play. I'm pretty much only a monthly player now and have only been a monthly for a long time. Although I did get the battle pass about 4 or 5 times, one for each of the weapon types. But yeah, since then only monthlies, and right now I'm pretty sure I've saved up to like 450 pulls, like if I pulled everything in together. Otherwise, we've got like a really freaking sick housing system over here. As you can see, I've kind of capped out on everything and my housing is not looking too good. Like you've got these lion statues over here, but like, look at this. The attention to detail sometimes, it really actually just blows my mind. And in this housing system, we're actually pretty much given every single asset that has been available in the game to build what we would deem our home in the game. And not to mention like all of the different elemental reactions that we could actually do, right? So like fire plus water is vaporize. We got like the electrocute with the water and electro, blah, 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 blah. Combat system honestly feels really fluid. There are a lot of different interactions. It's quite hard to floor, to be honest. And so with all of that being said, all of these different features, I want to start the discussion on as to why you, well, wouldn't want to play this game. So the first reason that I could think of, and it's that it's not that you don't want to play the game, but it's that you can't actually run the game. And I can't really blame you because some of these graphics are pretty insane, and the fact that it's open world, like, it could get quite demanding, right? And so although it is marketed as a mobile game, not only that, but like kind of omni-platform, all except the Switch, I guess, because the Switch doesn't exist to them anyway, sometimes you are in the unfortunate position of just not being able to play the game. And that is honestly fair enough, right? And so that brings me to the next major, most obvious point, and it's that you're not really into the action combat, like me hitting this guy in the face and then like dropping something over there to taunt him. And then he's gonna go get up and he is pretty freaking mad. I completely get that if you're not into this kind of combat, because like a lot of the traditional gachas, they have been very much like turn-based or like auto battlers, or like just a lot more slower approach in terms of gameplay. That's actually a massive reason as to why I think a lot of gacha players, traditional gacha players, are not playing Genshin Impact. Maybe the combat feels a little bit too slow. Like if we compare it to Honkai Impact, if we compare it to Punishing Grey Raven, the combat in this game is actually significantly slower. On the other hand, I was actually praising a lot of the writing of the characters before, but like sometimes, and on actually, you know what, a lot of times, there have been characters that were quite one-dimensional. So I'm talking about Bennett, I'm talking about Eula, I'm talking about Xin Yan. For Bennett, I'm pretty sure like every single one of his voice lines are like, oh man, I'm unlucky. Oh guys, sorry, I'm really unlucky, guys. Oh no, your cat died and your mom fell off a cliff? I guess it's because I'm unlucky. Kind of like trash characterization, I must admit. It's honestly really disappointing. And then we have the other chick from the recent event, Xin Yan. She's literally all like, oh, I love rock and roll. And everything that I do is gonna be like made into an analogy to rock and roll. And that's literally the extent of her character. That's pretty much it. Otherwise, if it's not the characters that don't do it for you, would it be because of the fact that, again, it is a lot of action, but not only that, there's not overly much auto or skip function. The reason that an auto or skip function exists is because I think a lot of people would rather put their like efforts into the gameplay that actually matters. For Genshin, I guess it kind of doesn't make sense because it is very much an action open world RPG with a gacha system. But then that begs the question, so the dailies as well as like your stamina gauge up here, 22 out of 160, I would actually argue that Genshin dailies are faster than the majority of other gachas. Me personally, I could probably spend like maybe 15 minutes to clear all of it, but then I guess the counter to that counter argument is that you can't just auto it in the background, so there is actually hands-on requirement for this. And for you to not play the game for that reason, I kind of get that. And actually, speaking of this resin system, 22 out of 160, this is an interesting argument that has been brought up over and over. A lot of players for Genshin Impact that aren't used to like this gacha kind of system, or like a progression locked behind stamina system, they get very, very, very frustrated the fact that we can't actually progress outside of these bounds. And so something like this, which is farming for skill levels essentially, a lot of traditional gacha players actually really like the micro progression, or the fact that we don't have to grind like 50 hours to max a skill, something like that. Because then you have games like Pokemon Master, which used to not have a stamina system, and it was just an endless grind. And so this is where it gets interesting, right? Because where most people actually wouldn't like the stamina system, I would imagine that gacha players would like the stamina system because, like, well, A, we know what happens if there is no stamina system, but also B, it's the fact that we don't actually want to sink a massive amount of time into this game or any of these gacha games, because like the main reason that we play it is that we're looking for something usually like a side game. And obviously I'm just generalizing, I'm not talking about everybody, but I'm just saying like for the people who are looking for a side game, this could actually certainly be it. And so yeah, this is a pretty interesting topic. It's the whole like side game versus main game versus gacha gamers versus non-gacha gamers. Like each of these segments definitely have a preference, and I think that most gacha gamers are probably going to be grateful for a stamina system like this. All right, otherwise the next thing I do want to talk about is the stingy events, quote unquote stingy. I don't think that they're stingy. I think all up we actually get like quite a fair few pulls. However, the methods in which they actually get these pulls out of us, as you can see, 20 freaking gemmies each time, 40 down here. And keeping in mind, each single pull is 160 gems. So like this is an 8 of the pull, and then this one's also an 8. It's like they take a pull and then they split it into like 8 bits or 10 bits or whatever, and then they like drip feed you. And so what ends up happening is that we'd have to do a lot of of like web events or whatever. I don't think there's one going on right now. And then for a small task of sharing a link to your friends or sharing it to your Facebook or whatever, you're gonna get like an eighth of a pull. And then you can do this quite a fair few times. I'm pretty sure mihoyo uses this tactic in Honkai Impact as well. But over time, all of that can get a little bit tiring, so I can see where that is coming from. Other than that, I think a lot of people actually just straight up don't like mihoyo. Mihoyo's reputation is, it's not like stellar. And unfortunately, it has been dragged through the mud a few times. I'm talking about like the lack of anniversary events, like the review bombing leaking into other games or apps like Google Classroom. And then it's the whole, oh, mihoyo is stingy, or like the Genshin players are all like freaking trash. So really this point is very much about reputation, and I'd be interested to hear whether that actually impacts your, well, willingness to play this game. I definitely know that when people see YoStar, they're like, all right, well, I'll give this a shot because it's YoStar, you know, they're generous, they're typically pretty good. And then you got Cygames and people are saying the same stuff, like, okay, you know, they made Precon, they made Dragalia, they made GBF, they made some of the best games in the industry. They also were like one of the reasons that Sparks were introduced. So yeah, it could certainly be that you think that mihoyo is trash. But with all of that, that brings me to the last point that I had, which is the insane layers of RNG for the gear grind. So for you guys who are not familiar, this is the artifact system. Essentially, every single character has 5 pieces of equipment. And so whenever you get a piece of equipment, there are multiple layers of RNG that we have to go through. First of all, you have to get the right piece of equipment for the right set. And then after that, you have to make sure that the main stat over here is the right main stat that you want. And then after that, you have to make sure that the substats over here are the ones that you want as well. And then after that, you have to roll for each of these ones to make these substats go up. And the allocations of like the stat increases is completely random, although apparently it is weighted towards the trash stats. And then on top of that, the amount of stat gain that you get for these substats is also randomized in a range. And so I think some players will be familiar with this, some players are not. Games like Epic 7 and some of the other Korean grinders very much employ this kind of system. And so for me, this system is probably one of the ones that would infuriate most people. However, funnily enough, I actually don't know if this system is what would cause people to actually quit. It would just make them very, very frustrated. And so that is essentially all of the different reasons that I could come up with as to why you wouldn't be playing Genshin Impact right now. Otherwise, it could literally just be as simple as, well, you just got bored of the game, and that's fair enough. And so with all of that being said, I think it's time for you guys to let me know. If you aren't playing Genshin Impact, then, well, did I hit the nail on the head with one of these reasons? And if you do play Genshin Impact, but you're on the brink of dropping it, well, let me know why as well. But lastly, if you are playing this game still and you're not thinking of dropping it, let me know what keeps you around. For me personally, it is 100% the open world exploration. Like, I love the fact that this world just exists and you can go around everywhere. The fact that the majority of these systems just make it really, really immersive. Like, I see a rock, I want to climb a rock, I'm climbing a rock. I'm not saying I'm playing Genshin because I want to be a rock climber, but okay, maybe I am playing Genshin because I want to be a rock climber. But regardless, let me know how you feel about all of this down in the comments below, and I would really appreciate that if you do that, because it means you've made it up until the end of the video, and so thank you guys so much. But otherwise, if you did like this video, and if you would like to see more of it, please consider a like, and if you would like to see more of me, then please consider a sub. But otherwise, as your girl Ganyu once said, all good things must come to an end, and so thank you guys so much for watching, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.